I think when I was a student, it was all about what I did know. Oh, I know this and I know that. And then as you get older, it's like the field and your vision becomes so much wider, and you realize how much you don't know. And it's like, whoa. And then events happen in your life. And one event that happened to me was my father had a stroke. And it was really a difficult time.
How long was I in there?
About 5 minutes.
Why are we not funding this?
I really loved biology in high school, but you know, I grew up in Southern California where everyone was in a band. So if you weren't in a band, you're nobody, right? So I used to love music. I do play rock and roll still. Mainly, though, recorded music in the car and home and loud. I do pick up the guitar quite often and really just practice and play for myself and with some other people maybe once or twice a year. But I love, my favorite groups are Rolling Stones. I love the Beatles, but Stones, I just love playing, you know. And then when I went to college, I wanted to be music, you know, a little biology here. And then I didn't like college music, per se. I didn't like learning all the orchestra stuff and all the composition stuff. You know, I just wanted to sing and dance kind of stuff. So I ended up going into biology and science. And then I met a professor who asked me to work for him for the summer, because I guess I was a good student in the class. He was doing research, putting electrodes in rat brains. And he'd have these rats in there, and he's putting electrodes in to try to understand, you know, what are the function of different parts of the brain. And I just thought that was fascinating. And I thought, wow, this is so great. So I started doing that and learning. I was, what, 19? And it just hooked me. So then from then on, I started to really deal with understanding the brain. That research really led to epilepsy research that I was involved in, because we know in epilepsy research there's a lot of stimulation. So we're trying to understand what causes epilepsy to occur. I think one of the things that I've enjoyed in my life is when you're a student, a good time to travel is when you're a student, clearly. That you can see the world, and you see the world through different eyes. I mean, when you don't have as many responsibilities in life. You don't have a big, you don't have big burdens that you want to be a millionaire right away. And so it's a time to go explore and to really enjoy yourself and to learn as much as you can and work with great people. I had the fortunate ability to be in Canadian universities, you know, one university, University of British Columbia, that I really enjoyed. And of course, Vancouver, British Columbia, and the university's right on the water there. It's a gorgeous place. I had the opportunity to kind of feel out various professors, and I ended up taking a class with Nobel laureate, the guy who discovered, you know, the synapse. He was writing a book with my advisors, you know, and he was the one who we talked, and you know, he's an older guy, you know, in his 70s, and he had done his work at the Australian National University, and he said, oh, you know, you should go there, and I'm like, wow, because I wanted to go overseas, because I'd met some people that were working with us in our group from Cambridge, England, from various places, so I applied over to England, I applied to Europe, and I applied to Australia. And I got a great scholarship there, and so I went. It was an awesome, awesome experience. Australia is a great country, and the people are friendly, they work hard, the beer is good, you know, they got good beer, what can you say? It's a lot of fun, it's great, and the education system is one that allows you as an individual, it's a lot like your honors program. If you are committed, you understand what you want to do, right? You really know what you want to do in life, but you maybe not the area you want to work in, you may not have decided, but you know what you want to do, then a British system's good because you can go right into a specialty. And when you get to your master's or PhD, you go right into doing research in the lab. You're almost like an American postdoc because there's no coursework requirements, okay? You just focus totally on research and writing papers and being really an apprentice to scientists to really make a contribution to science. That's what it's about in the British system, making a contribution to science. And if you don't make a contribution to science, you won't get a master's, you won't get a PhD. In America, it's a little different. But you know what's really interesting is, as you get into this, you realize many times how much we don't know. I think when I was a student, it was all about what I did know. Oh, I know this and I know that. And then as you get older, it's like the field and your vision becomes so much wider. And you realize how much you don't know. And it's like, whoa. And then events happen in your life. And one event that happened to me was my father had a stroke. And it was really a difficult time. You know, he had this stroke. He was in Houston. I went out to the hospital, you know, to see him. And here I am, you know, a researcher in the field and really want to, well, why aren't we trying this? And why aren't we trying this? And why aren't we trying this? Well, they're not approved by the FDA. They're all research things. So everything that was being tried on them was, you know, stuff that people had learned in school, you know, 15, 20 years before. So it was sad. I came back to USF and started focusing totally on stroke research for a while because that was just so critical to me is, you know, we know so little. I knew there was a 50% chance that in 5 years he would have another stroke. You know, I was at risk and others, you know, and things, and it's such a major disease. So we worked on it and came up with some therapies that we think might work. That there seems to be a window of opportunity following a stroke that occurs 2 to 4 days out after a stroke, where the brain is saying, I'm damaged. I've gone through all this stuff to get rid of all the damage, and now I'm ready for regeneration. I'm ready to repair myself. You know, I'm being anthropomorphic there, but I'm ready to really fix. So it's calling all these endogenous stem cells, our own body stem cells that we have in our bone marrow and other places, to come in and help repair. When you have traumatic events like that, our repair mechanisms may not be that strong. Okay, we can't send enough. So what we find is that if we can actually take umbilical cord blood derived stem cells, these are stem cells from umbilical cord blood that's thrown away at birth, and we inject those intravenously, these stroke at a certain time and a certain dose in a certain way actually repairs the brain quite well. And so we're gearing up to take this to clinic. Are stem cells controversial? Well, that one's a yes, because they are controversial. I mean, I don't think there's anybody in this country that hasn't heard of stem cells. And most people don't understand stem cells. Their opinion of it is based on their kind of own upbringing and their own feelings about politics and their own feelings about religion and their own feelings about life and morals and all these kinds of things. And that's rightly so, because that's how we make decisions about things. But in many ways, there's different types of stem cells. As I mentioned earlier, there's cells that we have in our own body. We now know that we have stem cells when we're born. You know, actually when we first fertilize, that's, you know, we have embryonic stem cells that develop, and those are the ones that people have real controversy about. And what, you know, and then as we grow up and we have stem cells in the cord blood, we have stem cells throughout life in different parts of our bodies, and we have them, they're quiescent and quiet, waiting to come out and repair or regenerate or do whatever functions that they do. And we have them all throughout our life. And that's what we really need to understand. In fact, some people now over the last 3 or 4 years say that aging is a stem cell disease, that stem cells don't function as well, they change their function, and that's what really happens as people age. So it's really, really important to understand stem cells. Is it important to understand embryonic stem cells? Because the reason embryonic stem cells are so controversial is that if you have an embryo and you're going to remove those stem cells, you've basically destroyed the embryo. Well, that, if you think that life occurs at fertilization, you know, when a sperm and an egg get together and you now have fertilization and you think life begins there, then you've destroyed life, okay, because it's no longer a viable embryo, even if it's stored in a freezer, you know. And so that's important for you if that's how you feel. Some people feel that life begins perhaps later on, you know, when maybe different aspect, the heart beats, for example, in a fetus, or when the baby's born, or different things. Those people may not have as big an issue, but you're still throwing something away. So it's really an ethical issue of what we call a slippery slope. That is, once we start doing one thing, it's not much till we, you know, oh, well, we can do this then, and then we can do this, and then we can do this, right? And eventually, you know, when you really first thought about it, well, we never wanted to get there, but it was just small increments over, you know, decades, right? And now look where we are. So it's really an important issue, and it's one that's really polarized this country in many ways. I think research on embryonic stem cells should continue because we need to understand the basic biology. I don't think we may need to make therapies with embryonic stem cells. I think that, in fact, we can make therapies with adult stem cells. My research has really boiled down to how do we repair the brain and other organs. I've started working other parts of the body, you know, in heart and in diabetes and other areas. But how do we really repair the brain following either direct insults of damage, such as traumatic brain injury, stroke, you know, these are things that happen fairly fast, or chronic degenerative diseases, such as Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, ALS. We all know that we have family members. And I'm sure in your class there, if you ask someone for their hands, how many people have some kind of disease, degenerative disease or heart disease in their families, you'd get probably a lot of people raising their hands, okay, grandparents or somebody. These are very important diseases to work on. And they're important diseases to work on because we really don't have any treatments for them. We don't. I mean, we have palliative treatments to help us live a little longer, help us live a little better, but we don't have something that cures them. And so when you lose brain tissue, you know, the best cure is new brain tissue, new cells growing, or new opportunities for the other parts of your brain to take over function of the areas that were damaged. Okay, so these are areas that we've been focusing on. And when you have a degenerative disease, you have the opportunity to slow it down, right? And that's so important. It's what's made HIV research so important, is that HIV at your stage of going to school is so different from when, you know, years ago where it was a death sentence. Okay, now we have ways to, you know, give drugs to, you know, to inhibit the virus and to keep people alive a lot longer, just like we do with insulin for diabetes. Okay, the disease is still there, the potential is still there. And so that's what we're looking now at, in fact, as an approach to when we look at Alzheimer's disease, is to do periodic treatments to keep the, in this case, Alzheimer's animals, we can actually have the same gene for Alzheimer's in animals and create the disease, and keep them from developing the disease as well. So that's so important. And these are the kinds of research treatments that we're working with.
I believe that stem cell research is ethical because I think it's very important for humans to really find out more about how they work, and especially because if the source of the stem cells comes from, say, umbilical cord blood, no life in anyone's definition is being harmed. And the results from that study will help our understanding and can really help to save lives, to save families, preserve the quality of life. For instance, I know in my own family, my father suffered from spinal cord injury last summer and is now quadriplegic and can't really move below his shoulders. This could really help, and I think it would be great in the future if, say, someone's umbilical cord blood, when they grow up, they could say, man, I helped someone's father or family member.
I'm a a social science education major, so I'm interested in not so much in the science behind stem cell research, but kind of how society's accepted it and viewed it. I think one of the big controversies, you know, that I've read a lot about is whether or not federal funding should be used to support research. And what I think is that, you know, there's enough taxpayers that have a stance against the embryonic stem cell research and the ethics behind that, that I think the money should be focused more towards umbilical cord, blood cells, and adult stem cells. As far as private funds go for embryonic stem cells, I think that's a different story. But for federal funding, I think the focus should be on adult stem cells and the success that can come from that.
I think the ethics of stem cells, I mean, I think it's a great idea. So many lives could be saved. I mean, consequences are something that we have to consider, of course, but I think that the positive stuff with stem cell research outweighs so much more than the consequences. I mean, yeah, we might do some weird cloning stuff that necessarily doesn't follow with the ethics of some people, but I think a human life, the value of a human life is so much more than a mistake that we might make along the road. And I mean, if we research this now and we do it the correct way while we can, that will prevent mistakes in the future.
Individual in my family who has Alzheimer's currently, and that is my grandmother. And I think it's sort of disappointing that she doesn't remember her own daughter's name, much less her son's name. I do believe in research that helps Alzheimer's patients. I do believe in stem cell research as well that involves Alzheimer's patients or any other disease for that matter.
I think there's always going to be controversies in research, no matter what the subject, no matter what the topic, because there's always going to be a line that someone starts to get uncomfortable, someone starts to say, okay, this isn't right. Like, in the case of stem cells, it's with embryonic cells, you know, you're essentially, if you believe that is life, you're killing the life because you're stripping it of its stem cells. In the case of engineering, are we going to go and engineer an atomic bomb? Are we going to push ourselves to engineer these weapons that we know we're going to go out and kill people? And there's always going to be a line that people start to feel uncomfortable. And for each person, that's the thing, is for each person, it's a different line. To put together all the lines becomes one big, large line of gray area where people are very confused on what the right thing to do is. And in research, there really is no way of defining that line. I think stem cell research is really, really important to continue to invest in and to continue to research in, because it's something that we don't know much about, and even though it can lead to people, it's been associated with things like abortion in the embryonic cases, and can lead to people being afraid of cloning and all these things, but I feel like people don't understand that in the case of most stem cell research, you're not taking embryonic stem cells, you're not taking basically life from an embryo. In the case of like adult stem cells, it's a stem cells. People don't use them, you're not using them. And then in the case of umbilical cord stem cells, it's just gonna get thrown away anyway. And it's got a lot of value in just learning biology, you know, learning the research that we can get from understanding biology and understanding how these cells become specialized and how these cells can be used by the rest of the body throughout the life. So even if we're not looking at it towards therapies, or we're not looking at it towards cloning, or we're not looking at it towards anything like that, it's got value in the biology of understanding life.
It's got so much advice to give, but one piece of advice, I'll tell you what I would do. The advice is be persistent.